Today in the news, we've got the big three, AMD, Nvidia, and Intel. What's up guys, I'm Snows, and this is your boot sequence. Let's get started with AMD. In case you haven't watched last week's episode, a user on the Chiphell forum is currently in possession of a few 3000 series APUs, a discovery he made in the last few days by unfortunately ripping out half of the APU's die was that the IHS is actually soldered to the CPU, unlike the previous generation 2200G, which used thermal paste. Luckily, he still had a few laying around, so he did it again, but this time properly. Something else he discovered was that this 3200G actually overclocks better than its predecessor. He did say that he isn't an experienced overclocker, but still managed to push the 3200G to 4.3 GHz, and that without much of an increase in thermals. In fact, his 2200G at 4.0 GHz actually hit the same 75 degrees Celsius as the 3200G at 4.3 GHz. He also did the same with his 3400G and overclocked it to 4.25 GHz without much of a thermal hit. It doesn't seem like he has done any overclocking on the integrated graphics though. I tried to dive deeper into the forum post, but unfortunately, the thread seems to have been removed from Chiphell. All in all, it looks like if you were holding out for an APU, this one might do the trick. You got better thermals, overclocking, and that seems great for an HTPC or a super low budget gaming PC. Personally, I'd love to just make an emulator-only PC out of that. Moving on, but sticking with AMD, it looks like they're going to spice up the Radeon 7 for their 50th anniversary. Leaks are all over the place on the CPU side with a 2700X prepped for AMD's 50th, but it's the first time that we hear about a Radeon 7. There are no details on the card except for this promo picture, and the main change is the color swap for a nice shade of scarlet red. It looks really good, and I hope it still comes with a brushed aluminum look. Not like I'm gonna buy it or anything, but it could be a cool collector's item. Next up, you've probably seen it earlier today, but it looks like Nvidia stiffed the reviewers with the GTX 1650. They got the card, don't get me wrong, but the drivers were not available to reviewers until a few hours ago, meaning that the card was already released. At $149, the card is a good price, I guess, but we can't really know that yet until the reviews are out. But do we really have to make a big deal out of this? I mean, there were no pre-orders, and if you wanted to buy it now, you could. I mean, you wouldn't have anyone to tell you if it was any good, but do you actually care about that at that point? If you're a smart consumer, you will wait until the reviews are out and make your decision at that point. If you're an impulsive buyer, you probably ran to your closest Memory Express to get the card, and there's nothing wrong with that in my opinion. Personally though, I'd probably try and find an RX 580 for around the same price. I mean, you get double the VRAM, and performance-wise, it's bound to be about the same except in Vulcan, where the 580 would shine. Then we have Intel with another refresh. Are you serious? What the f? Okay, it's not a complete refresh, it's still part of the 9th gen of CPUs, but come on Intel, how many times are you gonna release the same thing with the smallest tweaks? So we have the i9-9900, which is a locked chip with a base clock of 3.1 and a boost of 5.0. It's supposed to be slightly cheaper. In the i7s, we have the 9700 and 9700F, both once again locked CPUs with seemingly no differences except for the F, which means no integrated graphics, and it has a base clock of 3.0 and a boost of 4.7. Once again, a little bit cheaper than the K-series. In the i5s, we have three locked CPUs with the 9600, the 9500, and the 9500F. The 9500 is a new addition, but the only difference is a slightly lower clock speed compared to the 9600 series. And in the i3s, we have five new CPUs with the addition of the 9350K, which is an unlocked 4-core, 4-thread CPU. Interesting, but not really at the same time. You also get four locked CPUs with downgraded graphics in the i3 line. Perhaps the most interesting change, and I can't believe I'm going to say that, is on the Pentium and Celeron CPUs. The only reason why I say that is because they now support Optane memory, which might be nice for a tiny system that would feel snappy. Oh, and pretty much all of the CPUs now have a T variant. Those are supposed to be like super low power chips at 35 watt TDP. Sure, 35 watt. for an i9-9900T, 8 core, 16 threads. What annoys me the most is just how bad these prices look. I mean, most of these new CPUs might save you a couple of bucks, but they're locked, and Intel CPUs are really easy to overclock, so it's a real shame. What do you guys think about this? Let me know down below. I mean, at least it's not a 10th generation CPU. They just kept it with a 9. Anyways, guys, that is pretty much it for the news today. Hopefully you've enjoyed. Leave a like if you did, and as usual, you can click right here to see the latest video right here to subscribe to the channel. It would be greatly appreciated. If you have any questions, leave it down below with the hashtag boot sequence. Stay frosty, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Snows!